five volunteers. Okay, come up, you want to be a volunteer. You are, oh, for you. Okay, one, here. Okay, over here. Marin, I need you to stand all the way over there. And you're going to stand here, and you three stand right here. So, see if I can get this right. So, if you missed today's gospel, here's what happened. One king was born in a barn. Three other kings from far away get tipped off by a star and travel for probably at least 1 year, 2 years to ask the current king about the new king. Okay, so the current king, not happy to hear about the new king, because it means that he might not get to be king for much longer. So he asked the three kings to let him know where to find the new king. And they think that they want the new king wants to worship this king, wants to worship this king, but he doesn't. So the three kings go and find the new king, and they give their gifts, and they were warned in a dream not to go back to this king. They went back to their kingdoms far away. Excellent job, you magicians. As Christian tradition holds it, the three wise men, the three magi, were kings. But another description says that the magi belonged to a priestly caste of Zoroastrianism, which was a particular thought that paid attention to the stars. And this priestly caste gained an international reputation for astrology, which at the time was highly regarded as a science. That's how they got an audience with Herod in the first place. So the wise ones from the East were in part royal scientists that practiced other religions, and God used their faith and knowledge to bring them to Jesus. More ironically, God used scientists who practiced other religions to let King Herod and all of Jerusalem in on a little message that their Messiah had been born. They all missed it. So these men, whether they were kings or scientists or both, their journey was that God's Messiah announces that the whole world is changing, that God is coming closer to us, and nothing remains the same in the presence of God's Messiah. The arrival of these wandering astrologists signals that the reach of God's embrace suddenly is getting bigger than most people thought before. Because there's no longer insider and outsider, but all are included in God's plan. Now, this is not a new theme in Judaism. Back in the Hebrew scriptures, God promises to bless both Abraham and Sarah that they may in turn be a blessing for the whole world. But now it's actually starting to happen. Lines between people of different ethnicities and religions are dissolving. All are becoming one in Christ's love. And who knows what may happen next. No matter the cause for it, whether it real or not real, fear is a powerful thing. In response to these changes that King Herod was hearing, he, along with the rest of the leaders, fear this new king, and they come up with a plan to fight him so that they can kill him. If we had read on in Matthew's gospel, Herod goes on to what we call the slaughter of the innocents, where all the boys under 2 years old in Bethlehem are killed. Now, Jesus and his family escape as refugees to another country for which they did not have paperwork, but that's another story. Herod and the politicians, they didn't succeed this time in killing Jesus. But much later in the story, there will be, again, an unholy alliance between political and religious leaders of the day who will not only conspire against Jesus, but this time will capture him and crucify him. But we will get to that in a moment. Back to Herod. Herod wasn't ready for God's ever-expanding embrace. He wasn't ready for a king who ruled with compassion and not greed or shame. Wasn't ready for a king who ruled with justice instead of violence. A king who valued community and not individualism at all costs. Herod listened to what the wise men were saying, and he didn't like what he heard at all. He was jealous, and when we get jealous, we get scared, and we lash out in fear. We too can feel jealous when folks show up seeking Christ due to an experience they had, not here. And we have our own ways of reaching out and pushing that away, because we're more comfortable with how we understand God. We too can feel fear when folks show up with different ideas about faith than we do, different ways of being faithful. And more often than not, we circle the wagons, and we leave others out in the cold, and in doing so, we leave the very Christ child in the cold as well. And even with all of that said, the good news is that we have a God who seems to do whatever it takes to keep reaching out, to keep expanding that circle, to embrace all people. From the very beginning of the story, God announces the birth of the Messiah to shepherds through angels on Christmas. Then God uses a star on Epiphany to get to the wise men and to the political leaders. God uses visitors from our country to spread that good news. And from a manger where a child lies wrapped in beds of cloth, God's reach, God's embrace of Jesus Christ just gets bigger and bigger. And this child will grow up, and he will eat with outcasts and sinners and people who are God-forsaken. He will touch people who are sick and people who live with disabilities. He will even call the dead back to life. And ultimately, Jesus will draw all people to himself as he's lifted on a cross, when his embrace is the absolute biggest it can ever be. Because in Jesus, no one is beyond God's embrace. God used stars for the wise men today and continues to use them today. In a moment, there are three baskets. There's three sections of you. The baskets are going to come around with stars in them, with words on them. On them are different words. Each one has a different word, different gifts from God. I invite you to take this as a gift that God is giving you this Epiphany season. Again, it's about 5 weeks. And just as a physical star led the wise men closer to divine love, may your word lead you closer to God, the God who loves you in this Epiphany season. The word you choose is an opportunity, a chance to reflect on how God speaks to you. What might you learn from this word? What new idea might evolve? What wisdom might we gain? You're invited to take your star with you when you go home today and place it somewhere you see every day. Maybe your bathroom mirror or in your car, or take it to your computer, put it in your backpack. May it serve as a reminder that God comes to you in so many ways so that you can know God's infinite love for you. So the stars are face down. I'd ask you just to take a star and in some ways trust that God will work through whatever star you get.